All right, we are live.
Awesome. If you see another one popping in, I love how we're getting the prompt that this is being recorded.
You hear that?
Yeah.
It's okay. It's normal to have technical difficulties. This is a live webinar. It's all good.
Okay. Well, I'll let you do your thing. I'm just in the background. Okay.
Okay. Sounds good. So I see some people coming in. Also see our amazing guest speaker today, and I'm making her a panelist and a co-host. Awesome.
Love it. So,
how exciting.
So excited.
So I'm going to give people until like 4:05 to go ahead and enter the webinar episode. While people are entering, please use the chat and let us know who you are, where you're calling in from. We're really excited to have you all here tonight with us. I can go ahead and introduce myself. I'm Dr. Angela Rogers, family medicine physician and alopecia advocate extraordinaire. And I am one of the creators and co-hosts of this webinar series entitled Let's Talk. I'll let my co-host go ahead and introduce herself.
Hi, everyone. I am Dr. Renee Thomason. I am also a board-certified family medicine physician, currently work as a hospitalist. Also an alopecia advocate, co-host this webinar with the lovely Angela Rogers. This is a project that is birthed out of our hearts for our alopecia community. So we continue to hope that we're able to just kind of serve you guys and being able to help where it's needed. So welcome tonight.
Wonderful. And I was debating on if I should have the wonderful Samara Lane introduce herself now or wait for a little bit until more people join. Let's just have you introduce yourself now. You might introduce yourself a couple times, but I'm excited to know, have everyone know that you're here on the webinar with us today.
Yeah, thank you so much. Hey, Renee. Hi. Hey, Angela.
Hey.
I'm just gonna jump in. How are you?
Good. So happy to see you.
Good. Yes. Thank you so much for having me. I am super stoked to be here, super honored to be a guest speaker and just like chat and hang out with this amazing group of incredible badass warrior women from all over. So I'm feeling the love and super excited to be here. And yeah, if you don't know me yet, hi, I'm Samara Lane. I'm from Seattle, Washington, and I live in the Seattle area with my husband and our little toddler, our little girl. And I am a relationship anxiety coach. So what I specialize in is I coach anyone who's in a relationship and doubting whether they've chosen the right partner. So I really, through one-on-one coaching, help them to totally transform that relationship anxiety, commit with confidence, love their love life, all while staying totally true to themselves. And tonight I'm really excited to really talk more about the dating realm, right? Like conscious dating, dating with intention, not from a place of fear or blocks or limiting beliefs. So we'll get into that in a bit, but that's a little bit about me for now.
Oh, wow. I'm excited. Let me drink to that. Okay.
So just a little background for those who might be joining us for the first time. So you are on a part of a webinar series entitled Let's Talk. And it is basically a webinar series that is sponsored by the National Alopecia Areata Foundation, or NAF. And it's really just to provide support, a place for sisterhood and resources to women with alopecia or medical hair loss. And so we created this webinar series last year. It's been, I think it was September of last year. And it's been an amazing journey. We've had several episodes with specialists, including dermatologists, those from the mental health realm, as well as the integrative medicine and naturopathic fields. And so we've just had a really great time talking to women, sharing our stories, and really just making sure we talk about the hard, serious, you know, conversations that aren't very comfortable to talk about, but are so important for us to really grow in our alopecia and thrive while we live with alopecia, not just kind of struggle through it. And so I do want to go over some Zoom rules before we get started. So this webinar episode and every episode within this series is recorded. And so I just want to make sure that during the episode, if you ask questions or if you show yourself on the webinar, just know that it will be recorded and you're consenting for your face or voice to be used in this recording, which will be posted on the NAF YouTube page. The flyer was incorrect. Our session will actually be ending at 5:30, not 6:30, as the flyer mentioned. So just to kind of let you know about the timing, we do ask that everyone mute themselves. We will come at a point in the episode where I will allow you to unmute yourself. But while people are talking, please go ahead and mute yourself so everyone can hear. We will have time for Q&A towards the middle to the end of this session. And so excited to hear everyone's questions and stories and just really make this more interactive instead of like a lecture style. And then we will make sure that we place the contact information for Ms. Samara Lane in the chat. So everyone has the ability to kind of interact with her after today's episode. And then today's episode, we already kind of got an intro to that earlier, but it is a wine and sip night. This is iced tea, but any beverage of your choice. A relaxed session. We're going to be chatting as our amazing anxiety relationship coach mentioned. We're just going to be chatting about dating, relationships, and really with a kind of lens focused on alopecia and how that kind of changes the game and what we can do to make sure that we don't let alopecia hinder us from dating and from finding our special person and kind of just living in a healthy relationship. And so I am going to hand the floor over to our amazing guest speaker. And I think I might have you introduce yourself one more time just for those who just joined, and then we can go ahead and get started.
Awesome. Sounds fabulous. Yes. So if you're just joining again, I'm Samara Lane and I'm hailing over from the Seattle, Washington area. I'm a certified life coach. I'm a relationship anxiety coach. So what that means is I work with anyone who is in a relationship and doubting whether they've chosen the right partner. And so I help them through one-on-one coaching, through my signature program. I help people to really overcome all the doubt, ditch the doubt, love their love life, commit with confidence, all while staying really absolutely true to themselves. So I'm all about alignment. I'm all about doing things from a place of authentically you. And I can kind of jump into the chat tonight about, conscious. So tonight I don't think this was on the flyer, but a word that I like to use a lot when talking about dating, okay, is conscious dating. Mm-hmm. So by that, I mean dating with intention, dating from a place of integrity and alignment, from a place of doing things consciously that we act to create the results we really want in our lives, the relationship that we really desire, not just kind of falling into the same thing we've always done that we don't really want. Doing it from a place that's not from this place of fear and lack, I think, or scarcity. I think we can really easily fall into that. And dating is like, oh, it's a whole can of worms. So I can just kind of hop in unless you have any questions first, Renee.
Yeah. Well, Samara, tell us a little bit about what led you to becoming like the relationship and anxiety coach. Give us a little bit of a background.
Ooh, yes. Thank you. So I actually never intended on being a relationship anxiety coach, but many, many years ago, I'd been happily married for 6 years, but many, many years ago, I had the worst, like I came down with the worst case of relationship anxiety, and it was triggered kind of sort of when me and my partner moved in together, but then when he proposed to me, I freaked out and basically had a panic attack. And
wow.
And my engagement was anxiety ridden. Like, is this the right choice? Is this the right partner? And how can I know? And all this overthinking, and am I settling? And how do I know what's really a red flag or not? So that's where it started. I tried everything under the sun and nothing really worked for me. Everything fell short. So I went on this, you know, unintended journey to kind of crack the code on relationship anxiety, totally healed myself, learned so much about myself in the meantime, became such a better partner, such a better wife. Our relationship flourished, like everything. Even my partner shows up differently. Mm-hmm. And so much of that starts with our own inner work and our own path to growth, right?
Yes.
So I ended up becoming a certified life coach, and now I help people get the same results, and obviously in a fraction of the time. It doesn't have to take you years of struggling.
Yes. Well, I'm very excited. So you guys, we met Samara kind of through a mutual friend through Dan. She hosts the Alopecia Life podcast. She is awesome. Please sign up if you want to. So I'm very happy that you're on with us tonight. Being that it is February and that is Valentine's, me and Angela just wanted to just kind of talk about like relationships, because dating, when you do have, to me, like the hair, you know, you have a certain level of confidence, but kind of going into that realm where you don't have no hair and have alopecia is so many thoughts that you can have with that. I'm in a space to where I'm dating now, but it's taken me to build up a lot of confidence just to be even able to do that. You know, will he accept me? Will he like me? Will, you know, how do I present myself? I'm very excited to start talking about that with you tonight. Angela, what are your thoughts about dating in alopecia right now?
Yeah, so I've had so many interesting stories, I feel like, because I started dating while wearing wigs, and then kind of was dating through the transition of stopping wearing wigs. And then I stopped for a while, stopped dating. And then now I'm dating just without any wigs at all.
Yes.
And I should say I had like a couple years of therapy and kind of working on myself, because I don't even know. I think I like blacked out while I was dating and wearing wigs back in the day. I just like don't even remember what I said or did, but I definitely didn't feel like myself. However, I must say everybody is on their own journey. And so yeah, if you wear wigs to feel beautiful and that empowers you, then you keep doing that. And don't let anybody make you feel like you have to not wear a wig in order to have made it with alopecia. So that's like a myth.
Yes.
And that's coming from a doctor. So that's doctor's orders. I just started dating again on Hinge, and it has been like such an amazing experience. And I think the what happened is that the guys that I'm dating recognize that I understand my value and my worth. And like, I know I'm a badass. So like,
yes.
if you don't recognize that, then that's your problem. But I think they see that, that boldness in me and that kind of, that belief in myself that I am who I am and I know who I am. And I think a lot of guys are really drawn to that. And so it's, now it's kind of just picking out who I want. So I kind of, my question that I have for you, Samara, so like things are going like pretty well, for me on the dating, kind of dating world right now, but I know you've done some research on kind of alopecia and like how people struggle with dating. And so what did you discover? Like, what are your thoughts about kind of that connection between alopecia dating or alopecia and relationships?
Yes, absolutely. Beautiful, beautiful question. So, to kind of tie it all in, first of all, I think it's important to normalize, like you've already touched on, how scary or frustrating or daunting dating can be, period. And then like dating is awkward because it's vulnerable. It's freaking vulnerable to keep putting yourself out there over and over again, even when you have like you're in touch with your self-worth, right? Like it's vulnerable. And then dating with alopecia is vulnerability squared, right? Yeah. It adds another layer to it. So it adds a layer of, okay, how do I bring up my alopecia? When do I bring up my alopecia? How are they going to react? Am I being judged, right? So on the one hand, yeah, there's some unique challenges for sure. When dating with alopecia, on the other hand, it's an opportunity. I see it can be used as an opportunity to embrace the vulnerability that we all are facing when we're dating or putting ourselves out there in that super vulnerable way, right? It's an opportunity to face those fears, to look inward, to love ourselves unconditionally, to like stand in your truth, stand in your power, show up authentically and unapologetically you. But coming back to the vulnerability piece, to be a badass doesn't always mean, like, that doesn't mean be strong, like put on a happy face all the time, right? That's also a myth. Like even the most, like someone with the most confidence in themselves, we're going to feel the full spectrum of emotions. We're going to feel bummed out sometimes. We're going to feel disheartened or defeated or frustrated sometimes. So I see real strength as vulnerability, as compassion, right? For ourselves and for the whole experience of calling in our love, right? Whatever that looks like.
Okay. Well, I know that a lot of us can have like a lot of challenges, right? With alopecia. And I know that we talked a little bit about vulnerability, but if we bring up that word confidence, what if someone, especially like on this call, is struggling with confidence around dating with alopecia?
Yeah, absolutely. So here, when we're struggling with confidence, like, you know, fears or blocks or struggling to put ourselves out there, right? I think a lot of it comes down to fear when we're struggling with self-confidence around dating. So a really great trick that I would recommend whenever we're like feeling stopped or stuck or maybe a little down on ourselves or lacking confidence is to think of three times in your life where the worst case scenario did happen, right? Like where you were rejected or a relationship failed or you got a broken heart or something just didn't turn out how you expected. And then ask yourself, did you survive it? Right? And hell yes, you did, because you're sitting here right now, right? Hanging out with us. So yes, you did. And was it really as bad as the fear made it out to be? Usually not, right? Usually not. And most importantly, what did we learn from it, right? How did it make you stronger? Yeah.
Okay. I really, really do like that. Well, I can ask, so say that somebody is dating or they're new to their relationship with someone. You know, we struggle with, you know, whether to wear a wig, not wear a wig. What is like the best time to tell a partner about you having alopecia?
Yeah. So I, as you guys already touched on, I really do believe it varies and there's no right or wrong. Like it really is going to depend on you and what you want to do. And there's no right or wrong. I really feel like the question to ask yourself is, what would be an act of self-love for me, right? Would wearing a wig and waiting to tell on my own time when I feel comfortable with this individual, like, is that going to feel like an act of self-love for myself? Do that, right? If not wearing a wig and putting bald, beautiful pictures of yourself full of your dating profile and just like getting it all out in the open first thing, if that feels like an act of self-love, then do that, right? But really getting clear first and foremost on if expectations vanished and no, like about everyone else, what feels like you?
Okay.
Right, what's your comfort level?
I love this. And I know that I stalked your website a little bit. I love it. And I know that you kind of like put something, how people can come from like an empowered place and not like, I guess, leading with like a fearful or from a blocked place. Can you talk about more, a little bit more about that with dating and relationships?
Yeah. So just so I understand your question correctly, like how do we handle it when we're feeling fears or blocks or things like that?
Yeah, how do we empower ourselves? Even if like I'm across from this guy and I'm starting to feel subconscious, how can I coach myself or empower myself to just even let that negativity go, that fear go out of my mind?
Yes. Okay. So for that specifically, number one, and I'm going to go kind of deep. I like to go deep quickly.
I like deep.
Is number one, and I feel like we always gloss over this, but it's so freaking important, is to just sit with the feelings for a minute, right? Mm-hmm. Is to just first notice, okay, I'm feeling scared right now. I'm feeling terrified right now, or I'm feeling embarrassed, or, whatever feeling is coming up for you. Fear again, right? So whatever it is that you're feeling, sadness, grief, whatever feeling is coming up, and just kind of ride that wave, right? Like a surfer on the ocean, just allow that feeling to be. Mm-hmm. So often we immediately go, okay, well, I'm not feeling good. I'm feeling scared. So I need to empower myself right now, right? Mm-hmm. I need to just like put on the happy face, get my inspirational podcast on And a term I've heard for that I love is we can sometimes be doing what's called a spiritual bypass, like just immediately going to, oh, there's a silver lining and everything. And, you know, I'll just like say some affirmations and then I'll be fine. Right. So I love affirmations. I'm all for that. And there absolutely always is a silver lining, but we don't want to abandon ourselves when we're feeling some big emotions about something. Yeah. So just being with ourselves as those feelings are coming up. And again, that's so simple, but most of us don't do it. So I have to say that. And then secondly, I would then totally go into the, okay, I'm empowering myself now. And something that I love to do is when you're like, find yourself organically in a moment of feeling really good about yourself and just like, run into the other room, close the door, get out your phone, make a little voice memo, and just love on yourself for a minute and make a little recording of what a badass warrior woman you are and why.
I love it. Right? I love it. I think that it's very, very important. I think that, like Angela touched on, that we're all, even the people that are on this call, right? So Angela's out there, she's being a badass, you know, that's just her. She's like fully dating. Whereas me, I'm just kind of taking it slow. This kind of, I'm still, my self-acceptance is great, right? So for me, in the midst of dating, I feel that self-acceptance is like a really huge component, that self-love, hence selfish, because self-love is hella important. I think that is really important, like when you're dating. But what are some other ways we can overcome blocks from dating or even love if people are at that point right now? What can you tell us?
Yes. So get out your pen and paper if you want to take this down, because I'm going to give you a few steps. This is, and again, we're going deep. So, I would carve out some time, and I'm going to give you like a tool, and it's going to be a several step tool. It's very simple, but it's a few steps, and it's called a storyboard. So, to do a storyboard, you're just going to like take out a pen and paper. You don't have to do it now. Don't create the storyboard now, but I'm going to give you some questions to ask yourself later when you're doing this exercise on your own time. So when you're doing this exercise, you'll just get out a pen and paper and you'll write a big line across a sheet of paper, like a timeline. Mm-hmm. And you'll just make some marks. And this is your timeline of your life story. So you're just going to make some marks and just write down in writing on paper, what are the most like major life events that have happened in your life, good or bad, mm-hmm. but especially around the relationship realm. So how were relationships modeled for you as a kid, right? Was there divorce? Was there, you know, fill in the blank. What was your first heartbreak? What have been the positives that you've learned? So just anything. It can, and it doesn't all have to be relationship based, but mm-hmm. but definitely include those, any of those events that have happened in your life. And then for each one, you're kind of going to go past, present, future. So your past, you're going to look at the past, dip into it for a moment, and ask for each of these life events, what belief was formed because of it, right?
Oh, wow.
our unconscious is always thinking, it's always like taking external events and making it mean something about ourselves or others or how the world works. And it's kind of creating this false story or this false identity. We don't choose this, but we all do it unconsciously, right? So get brutally honest with yourself. What story, right? Like what belief was created by this event, good or bad? Mm-hmm. Then question number two is go to the present day and get brutally honest with yourself and answer the question, how did this belief help to shape your present day reality? Because whether we like it or not, right? Whether we believe this or not, our unconscious mind is doing is it's taking these events, making them mean something, making a story. And then we are unconsciously in our lives allowing or creating situations that match our story, right? Mm-hmm. So we all do this, myself included. That's the present day reality. Then lastly, we would go to future. What do we actually want, right? What do we want dating to feel like?
Yeah.
Right. What do we want our next relationship to feel like? How do we want that to look? And what do you want to believe is true? What beliefs are going to support that? What would a more accurate, empowering belief sound like?
Wow.
And kind of update those, upgrade your beliefs. So again, you want to give yourself some time to do this, but those are the three questions, right? What were the beliefs that formed? How are they shaping your present day reality? And what do you want instead?
I absolutely love this. I really, really do. That is some deep stuff that you were just giving us just now. It seems like your approach, I guess, from your coaching or just from your experience is that we just have to, it's about our beliefs, about our mindset. And, you know, we're all on different levels of where we are right now, but you know, it's a hard thing, but we can do this, but it seems like it takes a lot of introspection.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. It takes some inner work, right? And I think there's another myth that we have to do all the inner work while we're single and we can't be, you know, we can't ever be in a relationship until we've gotten, you know, mm-hmm. all the way there. And that's a myth. Okay. Mm-hmm. Part of our healing is done in relationships. Okay. Part of our healing is done by putting ourselves out there. So I encourage people, do your inner work, but don't just sit around and wait for it to be done, because it'll never be done.
I love this. Angela, what are you taking away right now?
Yeah. So I'm taking some major notes right now. I had my Google Doc already open, so I was writing, like, write it down. I was like, okay. I think you just answered one of my questions that I had. I feel like the first time I started online dating, I had done some of the internal work, but I wasn't like 100% where I wanted to be. And kind of now sitting here, I was actually questioning as you were giving us the layout for the storyboard, I was questioning, like, did I start dating too early? Like, did I need more time with therapy and working with, you know, my own past issues with relationships in order to like be the like perfect person to then go into dating? Because I didn't want to like ruin the person that I was dating, right, by not having done the work myself. And so, I love how you said it's okay. Like, none of us are perfect. Like, we all have issues to work through. And like, a part of how we work through that is through getting in a relationship. And if you have anything else to like elaborate on that part, I think that's so important, because I think with alopecia, like especially with alopecia, I feel like a lot, like even when you get to that point where you're like, okay, I'm doing great, you still go through periods of doubt. Like, that's like something for the rest of your life. Like, this is a chronic like condition that has a very impactful mental health component. And so if you wait until you're perfect, like you're never gonna date. And so can you just speak a little bit more to that? Just kind of elaborate on where you're going before.
Absolutely, yeah. So I love that you're having those insights and takeaways. That's beautiful. And absolutely. I mean, the person I was years ago when I met my now husband is so different from my present day self, right? And if I had waited all those years to be my present day self, I would have missed out on meeting him, right? And there's so much growing that we do together as a couple. There's even so much growing and learning that we're doing and up-leveling that we're doing while we're dating, right? So like, think of it as like your playing field, all this learning experimentation you get to do, learning like, what do I like? What do I not like? What did I think I didn't like? And actually, this is great, or vice versa, right? Right. There's so there's healing, literally there's healing that's done in that. So when we do, many of us don't, we don't come into dating with what's called like a secure, healthy attachment style. And I'm not going to nerd out all on attachment styles today, because that's a whole other bag that we could open up. But if you're curious about what that means, or you're familiar with it, like check it out. There's books on attachment styles. They're really fascinating. But like what we all hope for is a relationship with a secure attachment style, but oftentimes one or more partners don't have that yet, right? We might be more anxiously attached. So that might get, I don't like this word, but you know, the needy person, that's what I used to be, right? Like insecure. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? They didn't reply to my text message. Oh no. Or it could be, an avoidant attachment style, right? So I don't even want to date because I've been hurt. And so there's a wall. No, thank you. Peace out. I'm like, I'm going to kind of date, but not really. There's always going to be something wrong with everyone I date. So things like that, we literally heal them. Psychologists have found this. We literally heal those things by being in a relationship and learning secure attachment styles. Okay. Even if neither partner has one, if you're both working on yourselves, working on the relationship together, really putting on a growth mindset, like I don't have to have it all figured out, right? Mm-hmm. Anything is a skill. We can learn it. We can improve. We can get better. It's not set in stone. When we have that growth mindset, that team mindset with our partner, anything is possible, right? Even a struggling relationship can blossom, because if mine can, anyone's can.
Wow. I think that's so important, that growth mindset. I feel like in my medical training, they mentioned a lot about kind of like lifelong learning and how you can't just be stuck in one way of thought, or you're like never going to catch those patients that haven't read the textbook as far as their diagnosis. And so I absolutely love that idea of lifelong learning, growth mindset in medicine and healthcare. And it sounds like it translates to dating too. That's like pretty remarkable.
Yes, it totally does. Dating and relationships, same thing. Indispensable. Gotta have it. Growth mindset.
I love it. Well, I think we're open now to asking questions. Or is there anything else that you want to leave with us before we open the floor up to our attendees?
Honestly, no, I love you guys. I feel like saying that right now. So nice to be here and just connect. And you know, I can't see everyone's faces, but I was just stoked to get on this call. I've been in my house all week, as I know many of us are, especially if you work from home. And it feels so good to just like be here with you guys and feel the energy, feel the love. If anyone, like I want to invite myself as an invitation, if anyone would love some extra support around whatever is going on for you in your relationships or love life right now, absolutely take advantage and ping me, reach out to me. You can find me on samaralane.com. If you wanted to message me there, I also have a free relationship anxiety Facebook group. So if you or anyone you know is already in a relationship and you're, you know, struggling with that, you're having some doubts or anxieties around, am I with the right person, or is this relationship healthy or right for me? Definitely hit me up. I'll send you the link to that Facebook group. Any way I can support you, I'm here. So let me know.
All right, Angela, I will leave it up to you to open up the floor.
Great. So I would love to use the raising of the hand function, and then I can unmute you. So this is going to be an open floor time for you to get free advice from our anxiety relationship coach. So if you have a question or like a story or like something happened and you're not quite sure how to feel about it, like anything that you want to talk about, the floor is open. Go ahead and raise your hand and take a look at the participants here, and we will kind of get started asking questions. And hopefully everyone knows where the raising the hand function is. Great. Okay. I see somebody raising their hand. It's Jan. I'm going to go ahead and allow you to unmute yourself. So let me know if that worked.
Okay.
Hello. Hi, Jan.
Hi. How are you?
Good. How are you, lovely?
I did have some questions. I'm a long way from dating because I'm going to be 70, but I'm married and my second marriage. I've had alopecia since I'm 5. But, and sometimes I wear a wig and sometimes I don't. But I've had a lot more decades to make sense of it. But the one thing I know is that I remember being in an alopecia group when I maybe like 20. And I always thought everyone who had alopecia was just like me. And I realized that they aren't, you know, that there were people who were scientists. There was a man who had gotten through life being, he felt like he was the clown. So everyone has found their own way. And I think one thing I think about is the role of personality that we're born with, you know, the temperament, the effect that it has, and our learning style. So it's like alopecia to me is a piece of everything. You know, at times in my life it felt like more, but it is a piece. And it's just important to look at our other skills and talents. And I think I was just wondering that the different, I mean, how do you account for different personalities, different styles? And yeah, in that journey of whatever illness you have, with this, you know, others.
Yeah, absolutely. And just so I make sure I'm answering your question in the best way, are you asking specifically for relationships, like two partners that have different styles, or?
No, self-perception and, you know, self-talents, abilities, personality, temperament.
Yeah.
Maybe you don't see that or.
Yeah. So how does our temperament relate to whatever, you know, illness or whatever it is that we're going through?
Yeah. I was born very mellow. My sister was born really angry. I mean, we had the same parents. I could always go with the flow. I probably had some learning disabilities that weren't diagnosed. So I had this sense of being bad and dumb and for a very long time. So when I got into graduate school, I hung around with people who had the same internal vision, even though they were in graduate school. But I think it just has to do with, just the idea, if you have any thoughts, how different personalities, how that connects with certain illnesses.
Yeah, that's a really great question. And I really resonate with what you're saying, honestly. I am what's called a highly sensitive person. So like, I identify with a lot of what you're describing, right? Like, so sensitive to energies and maybe more of a mellow person than other people. Definitely not an extrovert. I'm an introverted extrovert or extroverted introvert. I would love to actually ask, hey, Renee and Angela, is there anything that you would like to speak to this on since you have more personal experience? And then I'll let you know some ideas as well.
So the main question was really about just personality types. Who spoke?
Jan.
How they interact with alopecia, because everyone has their own reaction, you know, just partially based on beliefs and experiences, partly based on their family. But I also think that personality is part of it.
I love how you said that we were all born with certain personalities. because I truly do believe that I'm not the same person who I was, you know, when I was younger, right? So it's taking life experience, it's taking counseling in order for me to develop into the person who I am today. So my personality is different, just my temperament's different from just even when I was born. So that aspect of just life and experience is just really going to be different. My personality is not going to be like your personality at all, but I think that it's just how you approach whatever situation or relationship with whatever you're in. It's just, I guess how you guys, I guess how there are the interaction, I guess. And even just kind of in relationships, I guess, like you said, that you're in your second message. I'm sure that you are in your second marriage. I'm sure you and your husband have really different personalities, but I just think that it's just from perspective and life experiences that will allow people, I guess, allow one to flourish like in a relationship, whether it's a friendship or whether it's a close intimate relationship. Angela, I hope that was helpful.
Yeah, I would say for me, I feel like I've just interacted with so many different people over my like past 10 years of being involved with NAF. I've been a support group leader for almost 10 years in Sacramento County in California. And so I definitely hear you, Jan, about like people, yeah. There's like a full spectrum of where you could be with alopecia, in addition to like the different personalities and your lived experiences and your childhood and like, you know, your current experiences. And so, I don't have any kind of like specifics in terms of how I think personality style kind of affects people with alopecia, but I can say that a part of the reason why I mentioned what I said earlier about like, if you wear wigs or if you don't wear wigs, like there's no good or bad in that, is because I think if I could speak to one point, it would be the kind of wig, headpiece, scarf kind of situation. And I think that relates quite a bit in terms of dating, because somebody wants to wear a wig and date, or wants to wear kind of a scarf on their head and date, and they're not completely bald when they go out to work or school or dating, doesn't mean that they are not secure in who they are. And so I'll leave it there. I have a couple of thoughts, but I think that's the most important thing I wanted to get across in terms of dating and wigs and headgear. I definitely agree with you in that personalities kind of affect, personalities definitely do affect kind of how you deal with your alopecia. And I think it also affects your interactions that you have with like therapist or like, you know, your mental health provider, whoever is working with you in terms of your alopecia. So I'll leave it there and I'll let our guest speaker go ahead and give her her thoughts as well.
Yeah, wonderful. So Jan, first of all, are we on the right track? Are we kind of answering your question?
It's fine. Yeah, I'm fine.
Yeah. 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 Yeah, I love that. And I would echo the same, and I would just say, you know, because we're all so unique individuals, there's no right or wrong way to interpret or our conditions or to navigate our challenges, right? Like giving ourselves so much passion and compassion and patience when it comes to what our unique journey looks like, right? Like if you had alopecia and your sister had alopecia and you have totally different personality types, you might experience it so, so differently, and just honoring those differences, right?
Okay. Thank you, Jan.
Oh, you're welcome.
I have a question. Well, I don't see anyone's hand raised just yet, but I have a question of my own while we wait to see if anyone has their questions or stories to tell. So I definitely had an experience. I mentioned this on a previous episode, but I definitely had an experience where I dated somebody while wearing a wig, and then at a certain point revealed that I was bald and took my wig off. And they seemed okay with it, but then I kind of felt like there were some kind of like compliments that really seemed a bit backhanded to me in terms of if they were really compliments or not. And then this guy totally like ghosted me. So like changed his number. Like I tried to call his number. It was actually like really painful. And so the question I have is, how do you deal with, if you're already in a relationship or you're dating someone, how do you deal with a partner who's kind of giving you this like negative energy, but you kind of feel like maybe you could get past it? Like what can you do in that situation?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I would start with what I call empathetic curiosity. So it's, first of all, people can, when someone else is coming from that place of negative energy, whether that's their own judgment or their own insecurity or whatever it is that's up for them, it can be extremely painful, extremely hurtful. And so oftentimes that's going to influence our communication. It's going to influence how we respond to that other person. I'm not condoning their behavior, right? But it's just going to influence how we respond to them. And it can just become two people who are in pain or two people who are wanting to feel heard and validated and aren't, and it can kind of just dig you down that hole. So I would say start from a place of getting really curious and asking questions with the sole intention of trying to understand their perspective. And as it's so much easier said than done, but really, really practicing not taking it personally, right? Because the person we're with has all their own hangups, all their own judgments. Every judgment is a self-judgment, right? So what someone judges in us is really what they judge in themselves, right? So starting from that place of just curiosity, right? What's going on for you right now? What are you feeling? What are your honest thoughts? Like, let's have an open conversation about this. And then don't go right into problem solving. Don't go right into anything. Just hearing, just hear them out and kind of go from there. There's often so much more going on than meets the eye, especially when someone is doing some kind of backhanded or passive aggressive behavior, right?
Okay, that's really helpful. See, we have another question here, a story. It's Troy. And so I'm going to go ahead and ask you to unmute yourself and go ahead and tell us what's going on.
Hi. So my name is Troy and I've had alopecia since I was 12 years old. So I had alopecia areata since I was 12. And then 2011, it had progressed to universalis. And dating, as I've been listening, you know, can be very challenging when you're first dating someone. And I just want to know, how do you tell someone that you have alopecia? I start off with a whole long drawn out story to the point where they think I'm dying, that I'm telling them that that I'm dying or something. And they're just like hanging on edge, like, what is she going to say? And then by the time I get to it and I say, you know, because I was 12 years old and I had to, you know, I go into all this long drawn out story.
Yes. Yes.
And then I find that I make such a big deal about it. Then they do. They're like, oh, is that it? You know, they just want to know, like, if it's contagious or anything like that. But how do you tell someone that you're dating that you have alopecia? Oh, wait, before you answer that, I usually wait to gauge to see their maturity. So sometimes, you know, when I'm first meeting someone and I'm not feeling that connection with them, and then I won't tell them because, you know, it's a moot point because, you know, I'm not going to see them again. But someone that I'm really interested in, you know, I don't know if I should just say, hey, I'm bald, I don't grow hair, or just how you say it.
Yes. And I can definitely give you some insight, some ideas there. Obviously, I don't know from experience, and I would really love to hear from others here. I'm sure there's so many great ideas, and this is such a great place to just speak openly and share thoughts. But something that I can start with, by the way, thank you so much, Troy, for your awesome question. And I would say if we're ever, I first, let me ask you this. I won't assume. When you are bringing it up, do you feel like comfortable and confident when you're bringing it up because you've brought it up so many times now, or does it still feel a little nerve-wracking?
It still feels nerve-wracking. I get so much anxiety just talking about it because it's the fear of not knowing how they're going to respond.
Yes.
And then when I don't see them anymore, it could be for other reasons, but I always think maybe it's because, you know, I can't grow hair, not that it's any other reason. So it always gives me so much anxiety because I don't know how they're going to take it or how they respond. You know, they may be polite and just say, oh, okay, yeah, no big deal. It's no problem. And then boom, gone, you know? So yeah, it gives me anxiety to say it every time.
Yeah. So I so hear that. And a lot, oftentimes when we're feeling that anxiousness, we preface, right? We do all this prefacing like you're describing. I am guilty of this too. So, and then when we finally get to the point, it's like, oh, was that it? Right. And right. So I don't think there's anything inherently wrong with that, right? I think you could continue doing that if it actually felt like the best way to describe it. But the sense I'm getting is it's coming from that place of nervousness. It's not really how you'd like to be communicating necessarily. Mm-hmm. Is the assumption that I'll make for the sake of my answer. So another way that we can really own it while still just being ourselves and not putting all this pressure on ourselves, because that is such, like, anything like that, I mean, it can be traumatic, right, for a 12-year-old to go through that and all these experiences we've had. And so when we're bringing something up like that, it is so nerve-wracking, like you're saying. So I would say, plain and simple, there's something important that I'd like to share with you. And I'm feeling nervous sharing this right now. Like, be really vulnerable and just say exactly how you're feeling. Right. Mm-hmm. So the only prefacing you're saying is, I'm hesitant, or I feel awkward sharing this, or I feel uncomfortable sharing this, but I really would like to speak my truth.
Right.
Okay. And then I have alopecia. Do you know what that is? Mm-hmm. And just shut up. Right.
I like
and
let that. Them talk. Yeah. I like that. Okay. Yeah.
And it's okay if you feel nervous. You might feel nervous every time, and that's totally okay.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Okay. Totally okay. So don't put that pressure of like, I gotta get like good at this or something.
Right. I know. Right? Like, it's like, oh, I gotta shorten this story because they all think I'm dying by the time, you know, I finally get to the point, you know. But it just gives me so much anxiety. But I just want to know how other people, you know, say it. You know, you pull off your wig, a shock and awe, or, you know, you just, you know, just what other people say, how they tell.
I love that. Yeah. So anyone else who wants to chime in, I think that's such a good question.
I can say for me, Tori, I'm just in a space to where that I wear a wig when I go to work at times, and then other times I'm just myself. So whoever I meet can meet me with the wig on or with the wig off. But at the end of the day, I'm trying to get in a space where I'm normalizing alopecia. And so sometimes I'll bring it up, sometimes I won't. But if they have a question, I'll just kind of explain it. You know, I have an autoimmune disease that attacks my hair follicles, and I've had it since I was younger. And if they have just more questions, like, I'll engage. But if not, I'm just like, carry on. We can just I try to normalize it and not make a big deal about it, because it is who I am. Alopecia is a part of me, right? So alopecia don't have to, you don't have to make it like a negative type thing. I guess just kind of build more confidence up. And like Samara was saying, just be your authentic self. I mean, that's who you are. You don't owe them no explanation.
Right. Yeah.
That's one thing. You really, really don't. Like she said, you can say alopecia and shut up, but if they want more, you can explain more.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess like if you're about to start like dating, I would just say just to kind of rehearse it, get confident in it, get confident in how you want to explain it so that you don't have to continue to go down that turmoil that you've been giving yourself or repeat that same story over and over again.
Right.
What are your thoughts, Angela?
Yeah. So for me, the only advice I have is just like choose your like timing well. I actually was running late for a reserved dinner date with a boyfriend at the time. And I decided to sit him down and tell him that I had alopecia in that moment. Cause I like promised myself, I'm like, all right, I'm going to do it tonight. Yeah, at the end he was like, oh yeah, is that it? Okay. We got to go to the dinner. but I really didn't get to like experience it with him. And so the next time that I told a partner about it, it was like calm environment. We didn't have anything RSVP reserved, you know, that we had to run to. It was just a night hanging out. And yeah, I think I just said, you know, hey, I have, similar to what Samara mentioned or recommended, you know, hey, I have something that I want to tell you, but I'm a little scared to. It's not anything that serious, but it's a medical condition, you know, it's not contagious, I'm not dying. But it's something that's very meaningful to me, for me to let you know, for us to move on to the next stage of our relationship. And then I, you know, I said, I am bald under this wig. And so I like took my wig off and just kind of sat there for a moment. It was really hard to not say anything, but kind of sat there for a moment. And he was like, oh, I think you look great. And, you know, it went really well. This is also the guy that ghosted me. So, and like, again, I internalize, I wrote in the chat, like, I do the same thing. Like every time like a guy leaves or, you know, things don't work out, I internalize like, oh, it was because I was bald. It wasn't because like he didn't have a job or like I was moving across the country to go to school or, you know, like it's none of those other things. It's like, it always must be that I don't have hair, but that's not the case a lot of the time. And so, yeah, it's, I really, really like this question. And I, yeah, I'm going to give a moment to anyone else who wants to share.
I like that feedback, just own it, not make it seem like it's such a negative thing. So I like all those, everything that you said, that everyone said, so I like that. I'll take a piece of everything of that.
Nice. Awesome. Deanne, do you have anything to share too? Because I see you're on the call, so I'm calling you out right now.
Okay. And then Maha is going to be speaking after that. She has a question. And I'm going to try to unmute you, Miss Deanne, to see if you have any comments.
So Deanne is the one who kind of glued us all together. If she's not busy, if not, we can go to the next caller or next person.
Okay. I asked her if she could unmute herself, but let's, we can go ahead and move on to Maha and have her ask her question. We can come back to Deanne if she has any comments. So I see we're going to go Maha, Melissa, and then Jan. So Maha, you can go ahead and unmute yourself and go ahead and ask your question.
Okay. Hi, Angie. Hi, everyone. I'm just really happy to be here. I'm learning so much from this. I'm not a person with alopecia. I'm just a person who have lost a lot of hair within the last several years. I'm 32. And then when I turned, I think 27 or 28, my hair was falling like crazy. And, you know, my entire life, I've always gotten so many compliments about my hair. So when my hair was like quarter of how much it used to be, it just affected my self-esteem badly. So I guess I think my question is very similar to the person who asked ahead of mine. I am in a brand new relationship, and he met me when I have my extensions on, and obviously I'm not going to wear them for the rest of my life. Eventually I'm going to take them off. I need to take them off, and I'm so afraid what the reaction might be, because he's said it several times. He said, oh, your hair is very beautiful and it's very long. And I've always felt like I was a fraud because it's not all my hair. Like 90% of it is not my hair, actually. And, you know, and I want to tell him, but I'm just really afraid of how the reaction might be like. Yeah, as I guess Samara said, just you have to own it. But I'm still, I don't know how to do this yet. So I'll have to figure a way to come honest and come forward and do it.
Maha, thank you for your brave question. I love that so much. And, you know, courage, the definition of courage isn't the absence of fear. It's doing the thing anyway, even though we are terrified.
I need to write that down. You need to repeat it one more time, please.
Yes. The definition of courage isn't the absence of fear. It's doing it anyway, even though we are terrified.
Okay. Gotcha. Thank you.
So you are being called, it sounds like your inner self too is like, I don't feel quite aligned with this. I feel like I want to just be myself, right? And I want my partner to know all about all parts of me, right? And so when you accept all parts of you and you do this courageous move of just being honest and letting it unfold however it needs to happen, the universe is going to show up in support of you, whatever that looks like.
Okay. Will do. Thank you so much.
You're awesome. Yeah. Thanks. Great question.
Great. Thank you so much, Maha. I'm going to move on to Melissa. And then I was told that Deanne wanted to comment to something from earlier. So I'm going to unmute you or ask you to unmute yourself, Melissa, and then we'll come back to Deanne. And then we got Jan and Natasha.
Hi, ladies. I just wanted to say thank you so much for hosting. This is great. It's the first time I've attended. I have a funny story to share. But first, I wanted to just speak to what we were speaking about earlier, how we always go back to, oh, he said no, or he doesn't want to be with me because I'm bald. I think it's interesting because even before I lost my hair, I lost my hair in about 6 weeks, all the hair on my body in about 6 weeks, 4 years ago. So most of my life, I had hair. And even when I had hair, I still internalized, like it was, I always thought, oh, it's, I did this wrong. And that's why he's leaving. So I think it's funny that, and now I might, in the back of my mind, I might still think, oh, it's because I'm bald. And I think it relates to what Samara was saying earlier about the stories that we tell ourselves and, you know, creating that timeline and really looking back at what we believe and, you know, what we believe now and just doing a lot of internal work. I've done a lot of internal work over the past year and a half, which has really helped me get to where I am today with being able to be free and be bald. And so when I date, I choose to just be me, right? I don't put wigs. When I first started, I would, you know, post pictures because I do online dating as well, post pictures with wigs. But I felt like I wasn't representing who I really am. I felt like I was being a bit of a fraud, just didn't feel right for me. So I thought, forget it. I'm just going to be me. And I think it's been a blessing because you're able to weed out so many people. Like you don't even have to question things, right? It's just like, hey, this person sees, maybe they're asking, maybe they're not, but it's like they're seeing me for who I am, which is a really good feeling. The men definitely don't come as frequently as if I have wigs on. But like I said, I think that's a really good thing. The funny story I want to share, I was out, this was pre-COVID, in a club with some friends. One night it was like a throwback to the 80s and 90s hip hop and R&B. So it's super fun. And I had my wig on that night, and it's a place where, you know, men are all trying to pick up women and it's just, it's hilarious, but it's a lot of fun. And so I've got my wig on and, you know, I'm doing my thing, dancing, everybody's singing along to the old school. And what I would do when these guys were hitting on me, and I would do it in a different way depending on who it was, but I'd like pull off my wig in the middle of the club. And it was hilarious to see the different responses. Some would run, some would like, I don't know, just stay and act like everything was fine. But one guy in particular, I have to share this because this was the best. So prior to, you know, when I had my wig on, he's coming up and he's all like trying to impress me, telling me what he does for work and blah, and he's just yelling in my ear and it's just like, oh my God, he wants to buy me a drink. I think I was in line to get a drink. And he's like, can I buy you a drink? I said, oh no, that's okay. Thank you. I'm going to buy my own drink. And he's just still talking away, trying to impress me. And I said, can I show you something? Like, I was engaging a little bit, but not a lot. And he said, can I show you something? And he's like, yeah. And I just looked, I turned and I looked at him and I went, boop. And he was like, oh, and he just started laughing because I was laughing. I was cracking up laughing and he started laughing, but he instantly changed in the moment. Instead of seeing me as like this woman he was trying to run his game on, I became a real person. And he was like giving me five and I said, okay. I said, you know what? Now you can buy me a shot of tequila. And then, and then after that, you know, we went on our separate ways, but throughout the night we'd see each other and we'd, you know, like say what's up. And it was just, it was really cool. Yeah.
So that's, oh my gosh. I love that, Melissa. Thank you for sharing your stories. Like, oh my gosh, I want to say so many things. I just feel like my heart was opening up the more you shared all of that. That is so incredible. And you're so right. You hit the nail on the head when you said, you know, it used to be other insecurities. Like I would project my insecurities onto why the relationship didn't work out. And now I just have this default one that's always in place, but it's something that we do regardless of alopecia. It's just something that we do, right? That's so, so insightful. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was a really awesome story, Melissa. Thank you so much. So I wanted to get back to Miss Deanne, who had a, it sounds like a comment about a story that was mentioned earlier. And then Jan, you're after Miss Deanne, okay? Okay, so Deanne, you should be able to unmute yourself now.
Hi there.
Hey, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome. It's my pleasure. I love listening to everything and watching Samara in action. I love all you guys. I just want to say thank you for holding this space for everybody. One thing that I come across a lot is actually, it's what Samara mentioned when she said, I think it was being empathetically curious and just being in that space where you, you know, we're not always saying, oh, they don't like me because of this, you know, X, Y, Z, whatever it is. And I have kind of an interesting story that happened to a friend of mine who's also a client, but she mentioned, she's like, you know, I was with this guy for, you know, 2 years. And then I was now ready to move forward. And I said, listen, you know, he knew I wore a wig and we were, Angela, you mentioned, you know, perfect timing, but they were in the throes of intimacy, let's call it. And he was like, yeah, you know, I'm totally cool with it. And she whips her wig off and throws it across the room. And he immediately had a physical response, let's call it. And in the negative way, right? And so I think, you know, we could all look at that and go, oh, he's, you know, doesn't love her enough. He thought he was ready, but he wasn't. She thought she was ready, but she wasn't. But on this very base level, we can kind of think of it like they're human, right? They're having a human reaction to what's going on. And she had developed this relationship over time and they're like basically ready to get married at this point, but it's been, you know, 5 years. And so you think about these experiences that happen and we just have to kind of say they're human, right? Let's give some power to that. I think that's really important. So, and it's not that they don't love me. It's not that they don't, you know, aren't mature enough, etc. It's just that they're human. So.
Yes. Thank you, Deanne. I love that. And by the way, I love you, Deanne, everyone. Deanne is the reason that I even like know what alopecia is. And I was so ignorant when I met you and like, Oh, you are like, she is one of my dear friends, and Deanne is who introduced me to the amazing Renee and Angela. So many thank yous to exchange, but thank you, Deanne, for sharing that. I love that story. And on the flip side, I mean, her partner could have had his own whirlwind of insecurities in that moment. Like, what's mm-hmm. happening to me? Why can't I, you know, stay in the mood or whatever, however you want to say that. So yeah, it's so true. Totally. And when it comes to relationships and intimacy and love and sex and this whole topic, dating, everything, it doesn't get more, like I said, not to be the, you know, not to say it too many times, but it really is. It's so vulnerable. Any insecurity that we have is going to be magnified. It's going to be tested, right? Because this is us in our most raw, vulnerable state, putting ourselves out there. And it is one way that we feel truly connected, loved, and seen by other humans, right? On such a deep level. So it really, it's really one of those things where we, like you said, just allow ourselves to be human, allow the other person to be human, and for things to be messy sometimes.
Yeah, I also feel like I'm trying to like imagine how would I feel if I were the partner and someone who I had been with and who I, you know, cared for deeply just kind of pulled off their hair. Like, I feel like I would have like a response too, because I am human. I agree. Like, we're all humans. We all need our space to have our own reaction. And I definitely wouldn't want someone to be fake or to cover up their reaction and just be like, oh, it's great. Like, you're amazing. And not like talk it out with me. Like, it really should be a conversation. And I would want that to happen with anyone with any kind of medical condition, right? Like, I'm not going to have someone just say like, yeah, and I have, you know, I'm missing a leg, and I'm going to be like, oh, it's all great. Like, let's move on and go to dinner. Like, no, like, we should be human and really respect their lived experience. And I would want someone to respect my lived experience too. So I really do appreciate that story as well. And we love you, Deanne. So I see Jan, your hand is back up. Now is your time.
Okay. I was just going to say that when I was younger and I was dating, I developed people who I wouldn't let into my world. People were very obsessive, who could point out every imperfection, who kind of had a panic attack if they saw a pimple. I thought, they're, you know, like, what am I doing? You know, so there was also judgment on my part. And that there's a time when you're younger and there's so many hormones. I think it also the idea of what do people see as the idealized man or woman, you know, like you have this when you're younger. I mean, there's this part that's growing up and you want many things. You might want someone you love. You might want someone you adore. You might want someone who has a hair, you know, different things. And that It was just important to say, like, who the, I clearly did not exclude everyone, but if I knew that I was gonna end up getting hurt because of that person's own reactions, which you can have a radar for, if they don't show compassion or energy for other people, it's like, you don't need to mess with it. That's all I was gonna say.
Yes, I love that, Jan. Thank you so much for sharing that. I so agree.
I have a question that I'm like formulating right now. I'm thinking ahead. I'm thinking to individuals like Miss Jan. I'm thinking about individuals like Deanne, like individuals who have these loving marriages. And I'm wondering, like, how do you continue that? Like, how do you maintain, you know, these relationships, maybe not even just romantic relationships, but relationships in general, and kind of continuously gauge how you're doing in terms of your alopecia and how that could be affecting your relationships? Like, is there anything that any way to kind of maintain a healthy relationship, I guess is like the question in living with alopecia.
Yeah. Can you give me an example?
So I am thinking of, there's a woman who is in my support group who is married and who they've had like a like loving relationship. I think they said like three decades at this point. And from time to time, like this individual has mentioned like feeling insecurity with having alopecia. And I should ask her next time, like, how did you deal with that? But I didn't. And so now I'm asking the question in the group, but how, like you, I mentioned earlier, like you're going to continue to have insecurities at some point, you know, with living with alopecia. And how do you, we talked a lot about kind of the initiating, kind of getting help and like with dating, but once you're in that relationship, like, you know, neither person's going to leave, but you just want to kind of like check in and make sure that the health of the relationship is going in the right direction. And that there isn't any kind of negativity being placed into the relationship because of your alopecia.
Totally. Yeah. That's a really great question. So, simple answer would be keep the line of communication open and strong. So, and again, just inviting that conversation to happen. Whoever is feeling, I guess, you know, and it really could be either person. So the woman, it sounds like a heterosexual marriage. There's a man, a woman and her husband. So she, if she's one with alopecia and is having some insecurities come up, if she's aware of this, right, she could take full ownership of that and say, you know, hey, I'm feeling these insecurities. I'm feeling this is coming up for me and I wanted to share it and get off my chest. And just see how that conversation unfolds. It sounds like she's already in a very supported, you know, supportive, loving, committed relationship. But new challenges are going to come up, right? We're never done. We're never done. And our marriages and our relationships are, they test us like nothing else, right? So equal reward to equal responsibility and work. So I would say, yeah, keep that going. Don't ever feel like you have to be done. Like you said earlier, like you've never arrived, right? You're never like, alopecia isn't a thing for me anymore, right? If that is the case for someone, great. But for most people, it's you know, it's an ongoing part of your life, right? And it's evolving as you evolve as a human being. One thing that I'll also say that I knew a couple that really liked this once, and I think it's a really great concept, is to have kind of a standing recurring date, like maybe once a month or even once a year, but do something like kind of a state of the union. Like what's the state of our union as a couple, and just talk openly, like, you know, get some LaCroix or some wine and just chat about like, what are we liking? What do we want to work on? What's been up for us? What are we each struggling with? How can we support each other? Like time to just dig deep together. So state of the union address together, I think is also a really cool idea that I've seen work really well for couples.
Awesome. I really like that idea. And it's, I think I should have been prepared for your answer because communication is like the foundation of every relationship, right? I feel kind of like thinking back to my relationships that didn't work out, like all of them had some sort of kind of issue with communication. And that was a large part of the reason why things didn't work out. And so, yeah, even though you're, you know, in a long-term partnership or you're married, it's, yeah, it's so important to continue to talk things out because, yeah, as you mentioned, new things are going to come up. You're going to progress and advance in your relationship and who you are individually too. And so, yeah, it's important to kind of, to keep talking. I like that state of the union. that's awesome. Okay. I see it's 5:18. I want to give a chance to anyone else, if they have a question or a story, you can put your hand up. You can type it in the chat. And if not, we're going to start wrapping up and getting some kind of last recommendations, advice, kind of healthy tidbits to take away from Ms. Mara. So any other questions or stories? Okay. All right. So this has been an incredible session. I'm so happy we decided to do kind of a more relaxed, like not presentation or lecture, but just a sit back conversation, just to talk about some of these, you know, pretty challenging topics that, again, like not a lot of people are talking about, but are important. So we are gonna close at this time. I see somebody wrote something in the chat. Oh, just someone saying thank you for having this session. You're welcome.
Our pleasure.
Yeah, so Samara, I would love for you to just give our group of ladies any kind of last pieces of advice, kind of summary or any other tidbits on you know, how we can proceed in our dating life and relationship life while living with alopecia.
Absolutely.
Someone had a late question. Just one more question, I guess, from the panelists. It says, I'm in a place where I want to start dating, but I'm not feeling very confident. Any helpful tips? Maybe we can close with that question.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you so much for that question. So again, it's going to be a lot of the things that we've covered tonight. So I'll kind of summarize just to give you some things to take away with if you're feeling I want to start dating again, or I'm just starting to date again, but I'm not feeling confident. And it's to remember that that really is going to come from you, and that 99% of people don't feel confident while dating. So it's okay. Like, I think it's first so important to normalize, give ourselves permission to feel messy and like we don't know what we're doing. And that's okay. And just the more you can embrace that vulnerable feeling of what, you know, what's going to happen, right? And how's it going to unfold? The more you can embrace that vulnerable feeling and just be with yourself and show yourself the love and compassion that you hope, you know, you would receive in your love life, the more you can process, right? So instead of recycling our emotions and having them kind of come out when we don't want them, it's to release, right? Release instead of recycle. So going to that place of vulnerability, just getting really comfortable with being uncomfortable is a big part of it. Standing in your truth, showing up authentically and unapologetically yourself. Like I think it was Renee who said this, you don't owe anyone any explanation, right? There's no explanation needed,
right?
You are the full meal deal right here sitting there. You don't need to have a backstory or anything like that. And you're worthy, you're enough, you're lovable, you were born that way, and nothing that happens in our lives ever changes that, not even a little bit. Again, when we're trying to navigate big questions, like, do I do it this way or this way? How do I say this? Or, you know, when do I share that I have alopecia with a new partner or something like that? First of all, you could just go in a dance club and take off your wig. I think that's an awesome way. Or, you know, ask the question of, am I choosing this from a place of fear or a place of love? And what would an act of self-love look like, right? As I'm dating, as I'm interacting and engaging with people, as I'm navigating new relationships, what would an act of self-love look like? When you do what is in your highest good, you automatically by default do what is in everyone's highest good. So really trusting yourself, like just trust yourself enough to do something and see how it works out. There's so much of that in there. And then some tools we talked about for handling the fear. And again, this can answer the question around self-confidence is, number one, think about three times in your life where things turned, like your worst fears came true and everything fell apart and it didn't work out. And, you know, what, did you survive, right? Was it really as bad as you thought? And what did you learn? Because whether it's dating or anything else in our lives, you're going to get dished more of those in the future. I can guarantee it. So embracing that and allowing it to be and learning from it. And then I won't go into the whole exercise again, but again, I would highly recommend to do that tool. Take some time, even if it's like 20 minutes, and sit and do that timeline, that storyboard, ask those questions around the beliefs, upgrade those beliefs. You're going to learn so much about yourself, even more than you already knew you possibly could. So I highly recommend doing that storyboard exercise and doing the voice memo, right? So last but not least, making a fun little inspirational voice recording on your phone, something you can listen to that just reminds you how amazing and awesome you are and how you can get through anything and how lovable you are and how fun and playful and light dating can be if we allow it to be.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Everyone, that was Samara Lane. Please check out her website, samaralane.com. I placed it in the chat. We also, during the session, mentioned Deanne Graham's podcast, Alopecia Life. Please check that out as well. We can't thank you enough. Thank you so much, Samara.
Oh my gosh. It's been an absolute pleasure. I love your energy. This has been a blast. There's no other way I'd rather have spent my evening. So thank you. Thank you for having me.
Awesome. Thank you guys for attending, and happy Valentine's Day to everyone.
Yes. I just wanted to say one last thing. We did put our email in the chat. If you want to be on our listserv to find out when our next episodes will be, please email alopeciatalk@gmail.com in order to be placed on our listserv. We're not going to send anything, you know, crazy to you. We're just going to notify you about upcoming episodes. So no spamming. But thank you so much for joining us. We hope everyone has a wonderful, wonderful Valentine's Day and a really great night. And we look forward to seeing you on the next episode.
Thanks.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Right. Mwah. See you. Bye, everybody. Have a great night. Thank you so much.